call this meeting to order. It's January 29th at 5:36 p.m. Can we have roll call, please?
Mr. Mays?
Present.
Ms. Popola?
She was here.
Mr. Nelson?
Present.
Mr. Freeman?
Present.
Mr. Davis? Mr. Davis? Mr. Winfrey?
Present.
Ms. Galloway?
Present.
Ms. Popola?
Present.
Thank you.
Was that a pass, Mr. President?
No. No, it wasn't.
Ah.
All right, can we have Councilman Mays lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance?
Mr. President, can we also have a word of silent prayer for our Councilwoman Vicki Van Brunn, whose brother died on yesterday?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Let's remain standing. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, per our new council rules, we do set aside time prior to taking action on any resolutions for public comments specific to our agenda. I believe a couple people did sign up for that, Ms. Brown.
The first speaker is Mr. R.L. Mitchell.
And just a reminder, there is a 3-minute time limit on this, specific to agenda items. Good evening.
Yeah, good evening, President. My name is R.L. Mitchell. I'm a member of the council. Desired at 759 East Linden Avenue. About this budget, opposed budget. Next 12 years, we authorize this budget to be passed for the, and I recommend the council peoples, you're doing a good job, but you're not even doing it as good as Mays. Because he, you think he failed this court appearance, but he gonna get a rematch. But I want y'all to know that. And he will win. And then we gonna be under the oath. Because you gave me 3 minutes to address that, and I'm addressing you with the 3 minutes and another thing, Josh. And thank you for taking care of Ms. Hennessy with a soft seat in front before she can recognize City Attorney Miss Blurts he be putting out to Mays when he try to talk civilized to you peoples.
That's amen.
Thank you.
Amen.
Our next speaker is Mr. Quincy Murphy.
Good evening.
Good evening. My name is Quincy Murphy and I reside at 322 East Myrtle. I'm here to talk on a budget amendment tonight. I haven't looked at the budget in detail, but I do have concerns about the weeds in the community. Recently, the Genesee County Land Bank for the first year is going and doing only 3 strips back when they cut vacant lots. Only the vacant lots that they doing full length to the back is the ones that's next to only residential properties and corner lots. That's a big problem for our community because Amen. It still is a safety issue. It will bring our property values down, and I just do not think that should be our American dream to have our vacant lots looking like this. I've been monitoring the vacant lots for the last probably 20 years. I've seen private contractors take care of the vacant lots. I've seen Genesee County Land Bank take over the properties. I've seen the city of Flint maintain those properties. So it's done been 3 different solutions to try to come up with these properties and maintaining this. I'm hearing that in the budget, it says that community development block grant dollars cannot be used because they have exhausted those funds to be able to maintain these properties. So therefore, I think we need to go back to the drawing table and look at other ways to be able to maintain these properties, because right now, what I'm letting you guys know, that me as a community activist, that is not something that I'm willing to say, okay, yeah, we gonna do this. I'm gonna be coming to this microphone, and I'll be coming back down here to city council. I'll be going downstairs to the mayor's office, to the administrator office, to the county commissioner office, to the senator office, to the congressman office, to the president. I will be going to everybody that I would need to go to the president of the city council, anybody that I need to go to, so that we can sit at this table and to resolve this situation. I've talked to Doug Weiland from the land bank. I went to the Genesee County Land Bank board meeting, but it was canceled. So I'm not just coming down here because this is what I like to do. I'm coming down here that I hope that you guys look within y'all budget and make sure that y'all can find some funding to come up with a better solution to deal with these vacant properties. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Murphy. That's it for our public speakers for that portion. We do have one resolution in front of us, 150488, and just as a note, there should have been a copy of that on your at your chairs before we got here, which is different than what was emailed to us. There was a difference in the general fund, that, which is on page 2 of the document, page 2 of 4. Initially, we were at 433, but now we're at 495. So there's a bit of a difference there. Go ahead. Someone want to make a motion just so we can start discussing?
Yeah, just for the purposes of discussion, Mr. President, I would make a motion. I don't see a particular number on the resolution to authorize budget amendments, but it's the whereas city budget is monitored on an ongoing basis. Okay, I see it at the top. Mr. President, I would move 150488 for approval.
Support. You're moved and supported. You guys want to talk before we talk? You want to listen to us talk?
The budget does it does project a fund balance, which is good. And as you can see in the summary that was presented by Ms. Lundquist, she summarized that. I hope you pay special attention to that. Also, this is a budget that the mayor has supported, which is reflected in the press release that was given out to you a few moments ago. And Ms. Lundquist, if you have anything you'd like to point out, some things about the budget.
Thank you. Thank you, Council, for having me here. The budget amendments before you basically just reflect the fourth quarter amendments, making sure that we are in compliance with the Uniform Budget and Accounting Act at fiscal year end. We looked at revenues and our projections for year end. So you'll see some slight decreases. The decreases in revenues as well as the increases in expenditures across departments were mainly offset by then decreases in expenditures in other departments, such that the net impact is approximately $7 million, or taking into account that emergency loan, which had not been budgeted for in the third quarter amendment.
Mr. President.
Councilman Mace.
I would acquiesce to the finance chair, but if the finance chair ain't got nothing, I will proceed.
Please proceed.
Proceed. Okay, I looked at these budget amendments over the weekend, and I looked at the ending fund balance for each fund, and I looked at the $7 million that came in from the state, and I looked at everything that you had forwarded us, and I looked at the negative aspects of each department, and when I got to the police department, I seen a difference on positives and negatives. What I had problems with and what I want you to explain to me is you got three columns, and one column, if I'm not mistaken, is dated 4/28/2015, correct?
Correct.
And 4/28/2015 was yesterday, correct?
No.
Oh, 4/28. I'm thinking 5/28. So today is 6/29. So as of 4/28/2015, you had everything listed as what would have been the current revenues and appropriations, right?
No, that is not correct.
So let's turn to page 1 of 4 and let me help you get me correct. So when I look at 18 million in the general fund state revenues, 18,663,177. When I look at that number, you're telling me as of 4/28, that's not the total amount of state revenues that we had come in? Because I read it as that would have been the amount that came in as of 4/28/2015. Is that wrong?
That is wrong. The first column on the table before you is the amended budget as of April 28th, 2015. So that was reflective of the third quarter amendment. So those were the projections for our revenue and expenditures as of 4/28/2015 when that third quarter amendment was adopted.
Okay, so that third quarter amendment was 4/28/2015. And you said I was wrong, but I'm listening to you and you make me think I'm right. 18,663,177 is what we received in state revenue as of 4/28/2015.
No. As of, for instance, May 31st, 2015, on the city's records, we had received 17,891,000 in state revenue sharing.
Okay.
So that fourth quarter budget was that at year end, we were projecting to have approximately $18.6 million in state revenue sharing. But in reviewing the activity year to date, having at the end of May approximately $17.9 million in state revenue sharing, we were not projecting. So we're lowering that projection.
So I understand, and I appreciate you getting me on the right track, because when you amended it in 4/28, all of those things that I looked at the weekend was what you amended it with the projection included. Once we got to the point that we're at today, you was able to look at those amended projections, see what the reality was, and then the middle column either is going to add or subtract what that reality was.
Right, and actually, may I correct myself? Sorry, I'm looking at, I printed a larger sheet for reference. As of May 31st, 2015, it's actually $13 million. So the $13 million is substantially below that original budget projection of 18.6.
Where are you seeing the 13 million?
Oh, that's just, I printed this off before I came up here to make sure that I was able to respond if you had asked where are we year to date.
Okay, so where we're at now, we're into the third column now. We're into the 6/29/2015 proposed amendments. So as of this weekend, when I looked at that third column, and the reason that you're doing the amendment, because you've been able to take that middle column and look at whether we was to the good or to the bad. If we were to the bad, it was in parentheses, and you subtracted it from that 4/28 amendment, and you got your figure that's in the column for 6/29, and if we were to the good, you added it. And so then when you go to page 2 of 4, for example, when you looked at the, we'll go back to page 1 of 4 at the bottom in the police. When we looked at police, the first two columns, police fleet and then gain 215, they were negative, 45,000 and 13,000. But then on the rest of the columns, police, I guess that's investigation overhead, police school liaison and special ops, they were positive. And so that's how you got the third column. You was trying to say something?
Yes, so I just wanted to clarify. So the difference between the revenues and the expenditures, the negative and positive numbers behave differently. So for instance, under revenues, when you're seeing in that middle column, the second column, a negative number, that means that we are expecting to come below projection, and that would be, it would be a bad thing. You know, so we're coming in below projection on revenues, we're not getting in as much as we had expected. In expenditures, when you see a negative, though, that means that we actually are expending less than we had intended, so that's a good thing. So, whereas above, they have reverse meanings.
Okay, so...
So the positive numbers under police mean that we're actually taking or reducing the budgets in other departments in order to offset increases in the expenditures for public safety.
So that's important, if I may, Mr. President. When we're looking at the revenue side, when it's in brackets on the revenue side, that means we didn't get what we was looking for. When we see brackets on the appropriation side, which would be the expenditure side, when we see brackets, that's good. When we don't see brackets on the appropriation side, that's bad. I needed that clarification. So if we don't see brackets on the appropriation side, that's bad. That's why when it got to the appropriation side, the more that we didn't see brackets in the police department, that was bad. I had read that wrong this weekend. She said on the appropriation side, when we don't see brackets, that's bad, correct? Well, I do.
I guess
for these purposes. For my purposes, yeah. That means we miscalculated something. It was more money spent in that area than that had been budgeted.
Yes, sir.
And so that means we've got to now take that. Most of the money that we take is going to come from that $7 million in the general fund.
So the $7 million didn't affect the general fund in the sense that it took away the deficit of the general fund. However, that was transferred out to another fund.
Right, because we had $9 million or less that the general fund owed the water and sewer fund at one point. And I know I seen $800,000 related to, I think that $800,000 is going to transfer back. I don't even know, was it maybe the general fund? But my question is, all throughout the year, something happened to get rid of that $9 million that the general fund owed the water and sewer fund. Something had to happen. Mr. President, I'm going to acquiesce and yield and might come back. I know we ain't going to be here all day. I'm going to end up approving these amendments because I could see in general what's going on and I needed some clarifications. And I understand that each fund is going to have a ending fund balance that would be positive. And when it's positive, I think we say it's in the black. Correct? That's one time when black mean good to the world. We'll be in the black on every fund. So when I looked at the, you hear that, Jess? I'm proud we're in the black. So when I looked at the water and sewer fund, Am I looking at that wrong to see that we have an ending balance in the 20 and 30 million? Yeah, I looked at this. See, y'all turn and look. I looked at it all weekend. And I'm talking without looking because I remember stuff. You want me to tell you what page I seen it on?
We're getting the detail.
I seen an ending fund balance.
We're getting the detail.
Did you see it, Mr. President?
Well, he's
am I reading that right?
If I may, okay. As I tried to locate in our audited financial statements for the fiscal year ending.
I can't understand you. You're talking fast and low. You gotta talk slow and clear.
All right, I will slow down. I have the audited financial statements with me so I can quickly look for the exact number, but the majority of the fund balance in the water and sewer funds are in capital assets. That's the city's infrastructure. So that's not all cash just sitting there. In fact, cash flow for the water sewer fund is very tight. The majority of that fund balance is the pipelines that bring the water and the sewer to and from, you know, the houses in Flint. It's the water treatment facilities.
So let's look at page 4 of 4 on what was given to me. Fourth quarter budget amendments for fiscal year ending June 30th, 2015. On page 4 of 4, what I was able to review this weekend, under the sewer fund, it has beginning fund balance $67 million and ending fund balance $72 million. In the water fund, it says beginning fund balance $29 million, ending fund balance $32 million. So what you're telling me is that's not all cash.
Yes, sir. Okay.
And so when we have assets, we can count those as a beginning and ending fund balance, and if so, that wouldn't just go for the water and sewer fund, would that go for the general fund as well? Do we count assets?
Yes.
So if we count assets, and I went back up to the general fund, is it reflected in the general fund as well? The assets. For example, let's say this building, City Hall, is an asset with some value on it. Is it reflected in the general fund ending fund balances? You know, the general fund ending fund balance might be, let me look and see. 400 and some thousand, right? That would include the assets such as City Hall.
So, generally speaking, fund balance is assets minus liabilities. So the $8.9 million fund deficit that the city began on July 1st, 2014, was made up of $7.5 million in assets and $15.5 million in liabilities.
I couldn't get that from the handout I had this weekend.
No, but the audited financial statements are available online.
Let me say this, Mr. President, as I acquiesce. The education that I just got from you on the middle column helped me tremendously as it relates to appropriations and revenues, the bracketed and the unbracketed. So I appreciate that. Also, the education that you just gave me as it relates to the assets being part of the ending fund balance for the water and sewer fund helps me as well. And so now I'm going to make a request that we hurry up and sit down with this council in a long finance committee type meeting, and I'm gonna reiterate my request that we get a walkthrough of this 2015-16 budget. I'm appalled that people lied to us and told us that we were gonna do the budget in the month of May and June, or whatever we was gonna do it, April, May, and June, and then the emergency manager adopted it and left. We've been forwarded the information, but just like we did on this little amendment, which is big to me, without a walkthrough with financial people, don't just send me a budget. You know, I'm still pissed off because of the outsourcing of the Department of Economic Development activity. Last year, I wouldn't touch the budget with a 10-foot pole because it didn't have economic development in it, in-house. It didn't have detectives and undercover police in it. It raised water rates 6%. Now we're in an election year, and the mayor and the city administrator and or the city emergency manager, they jumped off of that 6% increase, in my political opinion, like it was a hot potato, because you couldn't stand to have a 6% increase, in my opinion, for the beloved Mayor Walling in the middle of no election. We was ate him alive. So they dropped off of that 6%, in my opinion, like a political hot potato. That's just my belief. Now, as we look at the lawsuit that says some people might get 50% or more of their water bills dating back to 2011 or 12, the city administrator, the city attorney has decided, and from my information, to appeal that to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court might hear it and they might not. But I wanna do the walkthrough of this budget because I wanna start preparing for not only 2015, 2016, but I gotta look at 2016 and 2017 as well, because we in a 2-year budget mode. Now, I think it's going on a month or two that I've been requesting this walkthrough. So when you get my vote to amend this budget, this will be the last time that you can trust me, or I'll trust you. Anything coming to Councilman Mays and we ain't set up a special meeting, I wouldn't care if it's on a Saturday, to do a walkthrough of this budget that ain't been walked through with me yet, you won't get my vote. I wouldn't care what the R tab, the Q tab, the S tab, the B tab, or the V tab do. I just know, I'm winding up, see, when I start talking like that, I know you don't like that but that's just me. You won't get my vote. I'm sending a strong message to you, Ms. Henderson, as well as the new finance director coming from Ben Harbor. Remember, when I think Ben Harbor, I think Reverend Pinckney, and I don't think he was done right. So all I'm asking is for Flint, give me a walkthrough quickly, because this is the second type of amendment thing that done came. Am I right, Ms. Henderson? We had an amendment come before us before for 2016. This one is ending 2015, you know, 2014, 2015, but it's still an amendment. I want to walk through. Do you think we can get a walkthrough in the next 30 days or less? Mr. President, through you to the finance chair, you and the finance chair, is that a problem? All right, we want to walk through. Anything short of a walkthrough, Councilman Mays won't be doing no more amendments.
Can I just interrupt real quick? Do you foresee that being longer than an hour and a half?
It
that
is
maybe we should
more than an hour.
I do.
Yeah, so why don't we set up, you can work with, maybe we can come in on a Saturday.
That'd be great.
Yeah, like the 18th, July 18th. Are you busy July 18th?
Oh, I will make myself available.
All right.
Not July 18th. We got a birthday party. My son, okay. I'm sorry, it's been years.
July 25th?
That sounds good to me.
July 25th at 9 o'clock?
Sounds good.
You're going to bring the donuts?
I will bring donuts.
All right.
You know what I like?
Why don't
July 25th
tell me?
Doesn't work.
Whatever you buy. If Peter Bade got
July
a car.
July 11th?
I think you should
July
come.
11th.
No, that's good. It won't be for me.
July 11th. Can we use the committee?
How about this Saturday?
We'll come up with a date. We'll get back with you.
Now, you ain't going to make me look bad within 30 days or less.
I'm going to make, well, I mean, there's not too many more Saturdays.
Whatever y'all come
so
up
maybe,
with.
Maybe we'll get it the very first Saturday in August.
Yeah, y'all can do what y'all want, but I'm Mr. President, Ms. Finance Chair, City Administrator, until we get that walkthrough that I know what this budget look like, I'm going to stick with my guns. Mr. President, unless I hear something from my colleagues that jogs my train of thought, I'm fixing to be quiet and see what others have to say. But don't throw the towel in on me yet. I'm just being polite.
Okay, thank you. I've got Councilwoman Galloway and Councilman Winfrey.
If we can also, can I call you Jody?
Yeah.
Okay. If we can add to that, I'd like to understand the asset value in the fund balance. And I'd like to understand why we include that. I just was under the impression that the fund balance was the available funds, not including assets. So maybe we can have something that separates assets from the actual funds. That would be great for me. The other thing that I had a question about, and I just want to make sure that based on what Councilman Mays asked that I followed him. The very top portion on page one is strictly revenue, is that correct? On
yes.
Page one. And then the rest are expenditures, except when we go into the pages that have revenue and expenditure under, is that correct?
Correct.
Okay. And so when we look at the projection and the amendments, In the ending total revenue proposed for amendment, we have the $6,368,000, right? The $7 million is included in that net total, and the $800 transfer is included in that, right?
Yes.
I know it went somewhere,
yes.
But for purposes of seeing where we were, it's included in that.
Yes.
Which means that had it not been included in that, we would have ended with a deficit. Okay.
Without the emergency loan, definitely we would not have emerged from.
Right. And so, but the emergency loan wasn't for the impact of this ending fiscal year. It was for what we already owed. Am I not correct on that?
This.
This was in this fiscal year.
It would be this one.
Right. But we couldn't have projected. We already had an amount that we knew we were at a deficit at when we got the $7 million.
Yes.
Am I correct on that?
You're correct.
So since then, we've still run at a deficit, is what it looks like to me here. Am I looking at that incorrectly? Without that $7 million.
And I would like to note that the revenues that you see, those are the revenues that are being amended. So this is not reflective all of the revenues that we have for the, just say, general fund.
Mm-hmm.
Like, this does not include property taxes. This is.
Oh, so these are strictly, okay.
Strictly the amendments that we're coming forward with.
Okay.
So we will.
So we don't have a true picture here of everything, only what you need to change.
Yes, these are the amendments. Like,
okay.
We're requesting to be amended.
Okay.
Everything else is. It's fine. Like it
so
was
when we go
amended in the fourth, in the third.
Quarter. Okay, I think I get it.
So we will go through all of that with our the budget hearing.
Mm-hmm.
We'll have all of that information, like all of the revenues, and we can go through
Okay. And then I did have a question. And so when we go towards when we go to the appropriations, which are the expenditures or money that we saved, right now we're in a positive when we see it in the parentheses, right?
Okay.
But my question is, when I look at these, I'm seeing the city clerks, we saved $119,000. Is that what that says? On
yes,
page one?
That's
and
correct.
Then in the treasury, we saved 114, assessing 114. Am I right on that?
That's correct.
Okay. I think my question is, why did we save so much? Like, why did we not budget appropriately? And the reason why I ask that is because last year I went to the budgeting, and it was saying that many departments, they over-inflate what they think that they're going to need, right? Which means that it takes away from money that can be used in other places. Do you guys kind of follow what I'm saying or no?
We can look at it that way. We do try to budget. I'm sure that I wasn't here for that, but
mm-hmm.
I'm sure that they did try to budget what they would actually need. However, it didn't turn out that way in some cases. Some of these are very low, very minimal.
Oh.
So it, like the $3,500, and you had overall $935,000.
Right, but that's
so
not,
but
we're looking at 48,001.
Yes, you do have some that are higher. That does happen. It could be that you anticipated that you would do this and then saw that you didn't need to do this, or it could be that you're in a core meeting and maybe the city administrator says, hey, revenues are not looking good, so let's have a freeze. That's very standard to
mm-hmm.
do that. So a lot of things that you can get by with and that you can do without in your department, you go without that to try to reduce the bottom line.
And when we get together, what I'd like to ask, I don't know if it's possible, I'd like to use one of these departments as a breakdown example of what could have been done. You know what I mean? Just for my own training to better understand that. I mean, I went to the class, but it doesn't really help if you don't have an example of seeing something done.
Well,
I don't care which one you choose. I just would like that.
I think in the clerk's office, she has to budget for 4 elections, and if you don't have, you know, because you don't know if you're going to have 4 or not. So
we
maybe
turn the money back out.
Yeah, maybe,
we can,
and
we
that
can,
one isn't.
It doesn't have to be that. We can use treasury.
Okay.
Let's use treasury because the clerk's office is probably not a good example. Let's use treasury. And you don't have to answer it now. Just when we get together on whenever the day that we do, if we could just, let's just choose. I choose treasury. How's that?
Okay. Sounds good. Anything else?
Not at this time.
Councilman Winfrey?
Yes, just quickly. The first sheet that we were given at the end of fund balance, it was just a little over $433,000. And then now the new sheet that we were given at the on the end of fund balance, it's $495,000, and that's just roughly over $60,000. Could you explain how we got there? I mean, it's a good thing, but I still want to know.
The
your point of
on
information.
Page.
That's on
which
page.
One?
That's
which,
on page.
Page
I'm on,
two.
I'm comparing the old one that we had for the weekend and the new one we got today, and we're on page two at the bottom.
Go ahead.
Help me locate where you're at.
It's on page two.
Two of four. Okay.
At the very bottom, at the ending fund balance in the general fund is now 495 and some odd change.
Okay.
That's a difference from the original one that you were emailed, which was 433 and,
mm-hmm.
and something.
So okay.
That's what he's asking is what that difference is. And she's going to explain that.
All right.
It was a clerical error. I had in verifying all of the formulas. I went through and I verified everything down to total appropriations proposed for amendment
mm-hmm.
on page two, kind of middle of the page. So that negative 643,548, you'll see
okay.
in both documents.
Right.
But on the original document that was sent out on Friday, then just below that in the summary, it says total general fund adopted appropriations.
Mm-hmm.
And it should have been that negative 643.
Okay.
But it was from a prior draft of the budget amendment, so it was negative 583.
Right. Okay, thank you.
Okay. Anybody else that hasn't spoke yet? I got a quick question. Can you explain to me, I believe we budgeted
$1.8 million for deficit reduction last year, so $1 million general fund, $800,000 from the public improvement. Where does that fit into this?
That's what I want.
Right. So it's still it still went to paying down the deficit, so that $1.8 million we had budgeted. So we began the year with $8.9 million deficit, and we received a $7 million loan to help pay off that 8.9, but obviously 7 is less than 8.9, so you're still left with $1.9 million to pay off. So that $1.8 million still went, and then we found throughout the year an additional $100,000 so we could completely eliminate that deficit.
Okay. And is that where the $800,000, the transfer in, is?
Right, that's...
It came into the general fund and then went to the
exactly.
water and sewer,
yes.
rather than going directly from public improvement
yep.
to water.
Just a bookkeeping item.
Okay.
So, Mr. President, the $7 million did wipe out that, what the general fund owed the water and sewer fund based on what she just described.
The $7 million loan plus the $1.8
plus the $1.8 that we had set aside to pay over so many years. And so they still use that. Mr. President, if I may, when I look at the public safety narrative, it says public safety fund shows an overall slight increase in expenditures of $23,009. These changes reflect a decrease in fund balance of $23,000. When I look at that, and I also seen a similar narrative, I think in another area, is the which fund, the public safety, is that the one that needed the most help? Public safety is a large percentage of our general fund. And how did public safety do budget-wise this year? Did they overspend? And is it just, I know we did amendments all the way through, so I can't really tell what they did annually, but what fund was the most off of these that you named? You've got the general fund, the major street, local street, public safety, rubbish collection, building inspection, sewer fund, and water fund. Who was off the most as far as needing help?
Well, to address two different issues. So we have the general fund has a public safety, or like we have police and fire departments. So we are conducting public safety operations through the general fund in both the police and fire departments. And you did see on page one, for instance, an increase. So our projected expenditures were more than we had originally budgeted in police. And then the public safety fund is a special revenue fund because of that dedicated millage.
Right.
And as you can see, that's on page three. The public safety fund uses more than what we actually receive in property taxes in order to fund the operations of the public safety that's recorded in that fund. So in this instance, there was just a relatively minor adjustment, $23,000 in that fund. I had just, as we had gone through, there is an adjustment in the amount that's needed to be drawn from fund balance, because as I said, that millage, without the millage, our public safety department would just be devastated. But we have an adjustment there that we don't need to use quite as much as we had originally projected in fund balance.
That millage had been generating somewhere around, on an average, $5 million annually. And one of the big controversies, before you got here, I think you pronounced your name, Ms. Jody Lundquist. Before you got here, Ms. Lundquist, one of the things was, did we have to use that total $5 million in that year? Some people believe that you had to use the total, and then the finance people believe that you could use, for example, $2 million and carry the $3 million over. My question to you is, Did we use the total amount this year, and or are we carrying some over?
Thank goodness we carried some over, because we used the total amount this year and had to use the prior year's savings.
I understand the prior year, which might have been three for a total of eight, whatever it was. But my question is, this year we used the total amount and none is carrying over.
Correct.
Okay. So I guess I'll wait till we go through the walkthrough, because when we do the walkthrough, Ms. Henderson, I know last year I can't really get a feel unless I have a comparison of, you know, budgets from last year and then the increases in the various areas. I had two columns I was able to look at. I can pull my old records and go 3 years back. But when we do this walkthrough, I'm going to be curious to look at what departments is increasing and how much from the previous year, and that'll help me when I look at the next coming year. So I'll eagerly wait the walkthrough. Mr. President, short of the walkthrough, I'm going to give this amendment a go ahead. I'm going to trust him on this one, but I've said after this, without a detail, Ms. Henderson, you can depend on my colleagues. The RTAP can depend on them. But, you know, I sit in the RTAP meeting, intelligent group. I'm just as intelligent as the RTAP. I need a walkthrough. And so they asked for it, and people were very dignified and respectful. Oh, okay. You know, they the RTAP. But when Councilman Mays asked for a walkthrough, well, maybe we finally got to it. But I watch that type of stuff. I want to be just as respected or more so in some cases, because I'm the frontline worker, as the RTAP. Thank you.
All right, I got a couple more questions. You're expecting us to put this $495,000 into the rainy day fund, the budget stabilization? That's what you're expecting?
It's seed money towards the adopted fund balance.
And I mean, I guess, as you know, Councilman Nelson and I had a discussion prior to the meeting, the phone calls he's been getting. Councilman Mays was talking about the phone calls he's getting. I mean, does it make sense to maybe try to fund out of this money some extra dollars for grass cutting?
Hello. Boy, you smart, ain't you?
We did talk about that, and we were...
Who's this we that you speak of?
Myself and the finance director and the mayor and the city attorney.
He doesn't count.
We did talk about some things that we could do in the upcoming year meeting. Mm-hmm. We will be starting the 016 and possibly look at when we know our position better.
Mm-hmm. Because we're funding like $1 million into that next year, right?
Yes, but we do have some more issues that we're going to have to deal with that we will be discussing in the July 8th Finance and Administration meeting, and we will reach out to you, Councilwoman Galloway, about that. So we didn't want to make any decisions to go into fund balance without knowing, you know, our true financial position and take it into consideration the things that have come up that we will have to do to be in compliance with the state.
Like what? Can you give me just kind of an idea?
Like the reassessment of all properties in the city of Flint that's estimated to cost about $3 million.
Mm-hmm. We can't afford $200,000 right now to maybe go towards some grass cutting.
And that's something that we have to do. And if we don't do it, our revenue sharing will be taken.
So if we made an amendment to this right now, what would happen?
We need to work that out first.
Well,
we need to work that out.
Let's talk about it.
So I don't believe that's in the best interest of the city to spend knowing that you have such a substantial amount that you will have to pay. So it's like, if you do that, still going to have to pay that money.
That's fine.
and we're trying to work that out as staff, trying to work that out to see if we can come up with something. And we're in the stage of trying to do that. We responded to the tax commission, and we need to work that out before we take any of our funds and commit them to something else, because this is a true threat.
Have we budgeted anything towards that in the next budget year?
No, we didn't have anything at that point.
So ask that for
we thought we could work it out, and we are still trying. However, we don't have anything in writing as to how we have to deal with that if we like the number of years. So that's why we are taking the steps, taking proactive measures to say, okay, we project that our financial position will be here. And this is something that could go toward that.
Nelson.
I would further state that not only is that unfunded, the city received a notification from the state about this mandate to conduct this reappraisal, but also it's very likely that the reappraisal will result in lower property values. So not only will we be looking at the expense of having to do the reappraisal, we'll also be hit with the reduction in property tax revenues. So.
Is that $3 million charge all next year?
It would be presumably 2 years is what the state tax commission asked for originally.
Mm-hmm.
We're hoping that we can get that maybe from 3 to 5 years as opposed to us having to implement that within 2 years, because if we do that within 2 years, we'll have to pay for it within 2 years, and that would put the city in more of an emergency to do that. And so we're trying to work with the state now to work that out, and then we're also looking at funding, trying to find funding to help us with that as well, like through the state. At this point, funding has not been set aside, like the CGAP funding.
Mm-hmm.
That has not been funded right now.
Did is that $3 million firm? I mean, where
no.
did you get the $3 million?
We're hoping that we can get that down. However, we do have to look at it that it will not be probably cut in half. So even $2 million,
mm-hmm.
if we could get it to $2
million. So how do we deal with the grass issue now, then?
We're dealing, I mean, the allocation for grass cutting had already been with the land bank.
Mm-hmm.
That had already happened. We are going to meet to try to look at other ways to deal with that. Also, we have our DPW department. They are working on cutting some of the right-of-ways.
Mm-hmm.
It's not going to be as fast as even I would like, and I know you all are not pleased with it, but we are being proactive and trying to do what we can do. However, we do have to be realistic as to how fast we can do different things.
We've had a couple of different community groups come before us and say that they would be willing to step up to the plate, I guess. I think the cleaning green through the county gets something like $30 a lot, $35 a lot. So with $200,000, we could cut almost 5,700 lots. That would have a substantial impact on quality of life for our residents. You don't think that that's a worthwhile expenditure?
Mr. President,
if we have the money, it definitely is. I totally agree. If we have the money to do so.
And you don't think that we do, even with this little bit
no,
of fund balance?
No, I believe in being fiscally responsible. And to me, being fiscally responsible is to understand your obligations. And the obligation is that we will not get a pass from the state of the tax commission. I've already asked, and that's not going to happen. If it could happen, I definitely agree with you. That's important. That's a priority, and it's taken into consideration with the funds that are committed to CDBG. Also, it's taken into consideration with DPW coming up with funding to help with that as well.
Do we have any block grant dollars that are unallocated?
I would have to go back and look at that.
Seems
we
to me
have
we
been allocating those, and we would even have to look at the stipulation as to what could be done with the DPW dollars. I have spoken with Ms. Hunter about what we could do, like as far as the neighborhood cleanup, and how we could take care of some of the city lots with that money as well. So we are working on it. Flint and DPW, they're working on the right ways as we speak. So that's where we are with that. But I would not recommend allocating $200,000 now to that because of the emergency that we're in. I don't want to get us back into an emergency by allocating $200,000 when I know we have a $2 to $3 million obligation. In addition to that, we have the millage that we don't know if that will be passed either. We're in an emergency and we have to operate as such.
Mr. President.
How about $195,000? Just kidding. I got Councilwoman Poplar and then Councilman Nelson and then Councilman Mays.
Thank you, Mr. President. So in other words, Ms. Henderson, we have no funds to cut grass.
We do have an allocation, and that allocation was from CDBG.
And, well, why the grass hasn't been cut?
The land bank, they do cut the grass, but it's not up to, it's not as often as we probably would like.
When I have grass taller than a 3 and 4 year old child, I'm not very pleased. The mother of the child not pleased, and the child is not pleased. But we sit here talking about some budget amendments, and the people, the ones that's paying your salary, my salary, the lights in this building, and they can't get the grass cut, shame on us. Shame. And then we find a little bit of money and we can't use that. When do we get to a point where we can use something to help the people? I'm here for the people. I don't know what y'all here for. But the people put me in this seat. And they tired of being dogged out. Completely dogged out. If you find $10, you can't use that for the people. If you find $5, you can't use it. You got to hold on for something else. And talking about the people in Lansing, they go to their little perfect patty houses where they got grass cut. They don't give a hoot nor a holler about these people around here. And now here we are, acting like we don't care about them. Well, I care about them. So you can take your budget amendment.
Thank you, Brother Chairman, Brother President. Ms. Henderson and to Ms. Is, can I call you Jody? Is that all right? You know, I've sit here and listen, and you said, Ms. Henderson, you don't think it would be a wise decision to take $200,000 when I'm looking at $495,000 that's in available in the fund, and you want us to put it all in the rainy day. And as Ms. Poplar have stated, the people that we represent, they get nothing. No one said anything about, of course, we need a new financial officer. She's doing a good job. But her salary alone would cut a whole lot of lots. We cannot allocate $200,000 tonight to take care of the people of this city who pay taxes, who pay these high water bills, who pay street light taxes. We can't. That wouldn't be a wise thing to do. When is it unwise when you don't, if you take care of somebody that surely pays taxes in this city? When is that unwise? I think that's a very smart decision to take care of the people of this city. It looks mighty bad when we don't take care of those who pay our paychecks. Mine, yours, everybody here at City Hall. How would it go out in the community that is not wise to take $200,000 and allocate to cut grass that I have to ease out into the middle of intersections because you can't see? And the minute someone gets hurt or killed, this city is in trouble. And you're talking about emergency finance manager coming back or the state gonna take back over. Let that happen because of high grass. Let that happen. Some of these intersections are so, you have to just take your time and ease out because you can't see. I went on streets the other day. Our elderly people are keeping their yards up the best they can, real pretty and nice, and across the street, grass is that high, taller than me. So when is that not smart, taking care of the people of this city? Now, I don't know about nobody else what they're going to do. I don't. But I came in here in the spirit of cooperation. Mr. May said he's going to go this time and next time if he don't get the walkthrough. Well, what I just heard is enough for me. I'm not going to give you to the next time for a walkthrough. And you're going to have to go to the RTAB. Because if you're not going to take care of the people of this city, these budget amendments that y'all say is so right for us to do, until we get to $200,000 to cut grass for the citizens of this city, I got a problem. So tonight, I don't know about nobody else, and I ain't going to try to talk to nobody else. But me, in this ship, is saying no. Now, you can go anywhere you want to go. The RTAB's going to have to do it, I guess. It may walk and may fly tonight. I'm just one vote. But if something struck my nerve when you said it's not a wise decision, I'm just being honest, when you said it's not a wise decision to do that, to take $200,000, you still got $295,000 you can put in the rainy day. And we can start cutting the grass like it should be cut. I'm not worried about what land bank doing. I want us to step to the plate and let's take care of our citizens. Mr. President, I thank you for the time. I'm finished.
All right. Mr. President, I thank you. Ms. Henderson, let me say to you that before you got here, it was some kids walking on this high grass issue. I think they was on Fleming Road. The record might show they got hit, and it was a problem. So we've seen that history with this high grass. It is a real safety issue. I know of the money that was allocated. I think it was $500,000 found in the street fund, $100,000 according to Kay Mohammed, was reallocated, and people put bids out for the right of way. They said they were going to cut between the sidewalk and the street. I say the right of way is fine, but we need it cut all the way. And so I use that type of communications, the right of way, we need it all of the way. The first ward, if you check the record of the land bank, it was kind of cut first. First ward was cut first, and I predicted by the end of May, June, the end of June, it would be like a jungle over there. I even asked, I said, I want to show it to you, you know. I wanted you to see the first ward. And if you got the calls that I got, I said, it makes me look stupid. But I'm not going to end up looking stupid, because when the people call me to represent them, the charter says that as a council person, I can ask, I can inquire that it be done. But the charter says that the mayor and the administration can order employees and staff to do stuff. So I've asked for a month or two about this grass. Now, some of my colleagues, I know for a fact, some of them out campaigning with the mayor. See, I'm political. You downstairs with the mayor, he has a responsibility of every ward all across the city. Some of my colleagues who up here hollering, they campaigning with the mayor, but now it's showtime. See, I am a candidate for mayor. And if I'm the mayor, I'm ordering and raising hell for this grass and weeds to be cut. But I ain't heard a peep from the mayor. And I know some of my colleagues and their buddies is campaigning with the mayor. And I know that the mayor see you way more than I do. Y'all in the same office, the same corridor. So I know what Councilman Mays has done. He's hollered about it in committee meetings. He's hollered on the floor. Now you got the president and other council people saying they won't pass an amendment. They politic, and some of the same ones you hear howling about this grass is with the mayor. They should have had their candidate mayor come up here and holler with them, because he talks for all wards. So I want the city to know that I'm hollering about grass, it's the mayor and his buddies hollering. Now let me say this, I said once that if the mayor think he can make me look bad and you gonna conspire and help the mayor, Ms. Henderson, you got another thing coming. Because a council person can ask to get it done, but a city administrator and the mayor can order and direct employees. Ms. Henderson, when I sit in the RTAB meeting, they said no matter what y'all do, it's got to come before the RTAB. It blows my mind to believe that we gonna vote today on a budget amendment that takes place, the fiscal year starts Wednesday. The RTAB won't meet between now and Wednesday. So these budget amendments, if they have to be approved by the RTAB, it's throwing me off. It throws me way off, because here we fixing to meet and approve some budget amendments like it's real on a, what's the date, Josh, Monday? Today is Monday, and the date today is the 29th. And the fiscal year starts July the 1st, and I asked the RTAB, do y'all have a vehicle for special meetings? I said, y'all make me feel stupid, because why would I rush to have a special meeting to approve a budget amendment that would take place Wednesday, July the 1st, like it really means something, and our actions don't mean a thing? So when you see these politicians politicking, talking about let the RTAB do it, I wouldn't care what they did tonight. From what I understand, it's meaningless anyway in a timely manner. What is this exercise? What is this charades? What are we doing here? What are we going through? I would say this to you. Kids getting hit, bit by rodents and raccoons, high grass everywhere. That's the complaints I'm getting. The tool shed, Ms. Henderson, been using block grant money. And you know what Alonzo Nim tell me? They say that the stipulations to the block grant money, if they go try to get a zero turn, we allocated them $60,000, Ms. Ludquist. They have to get three bids, and everything have to be identical. They might have to get a bid from Ohio, one from Atherton Road Sales and Service, and if the machine is identical and the blade is different, it don't meet the three specs for the hood money that we allocated to the tool shed. Let me say this to you. I went and took a class, a three-hour class to use the machines from the tool shed. I asked for a $15,000 allocation for the tool shed where they could get another zero turn and a walking brush hog. Because I said as a council person, I will ride it all day long and I will cut it. See, the tool shed have an umbrella policy for liability when we go up there and check out the tools. They only have one zero turn, one brush haul.
Councilman, can you please wrap it up on the tool shed?
Well, the tool shed is a way to cut this right. stuff. It might be one of the cheapest ways, because block club members and council people who fall up under that umbrella policy, and you hear me saying myself, Ms. Henderson, and Mr. President, in all due respect, you got council people saying that if we don't make a move on getting some of this $400,000 or so reallocated, they'll vote no. And I believe them, because they said it. But I know the politics of some of this stuff. So I want Ms. Henderson and Ms. Ludquist to understand, even if you put the $400,000 in the rainy day fund, you got a 12 to 15% rainy day fund. When we talked in budget Yes, 12 to 15%, ain't it? Not out of this budget, but that's kind of what we've talked about over the years, Ms. Lundquist. We want to have a rainy day fund or reserve fund that reflects 12 to 15% of something. You frown. You don't know what I'm talking about?
If I may. So even if the $400,000 is coupled with the $1 million that's been set aside, it's a long ways from 12 to 15%. And while this city is facing a number of different fronts, you know, lawsuits on the pension side, a severely underfunded pension system, there are very real risks that face the city that have long preceded anyone that's sitting here, long preceded me. This is only my 11th, you know, day in this seat. It's just important to balance our long-term financial objectives for the stability of Flint with our short-term, you know, keeping in mind then those strategic objectives and the citizens and what we can do for them, but also, you know, maybe it is up to the council to determine your priorities where you're gonna set the budget.
Let me cut through the chase, Mr. President. Ms. Lundquist, let me explain this. I would have been satisfied going another year with Ms. Steele. I don't need you here. I could have dealt with Ms. Steele. She was an interim finance person. We didn't get nothing now. We ain't getting nothing in. I could have went with Ms. Steele. You making $95,000. Keep in mind, Ms. Lundquist, I can cut $100,000 or $95,000 from the top. When we make a simple request with the understanding we have, we know the understanding of the budget. Some people made foolish mistakes before I got here. See, you meeting Councilman Mays. Councilman Mays been on the council a year and 6 months. If some people been here 8 years, 4 years, and 20 years. So believe me, ma'am, once we do the walkthrough, I'll show you where to find $95,000. All we saying right now, Ms. Henderson and Ms. Lundquist, until we do the walkthrough, give us a shot at it. We know how to go through a fiscal year and $95,000. You know, we got friends in Lansing. The minute people wasn't on the ballot, you seen Anna, Nick, and Neely near move and did something in Lansing you ain't never seen before. They enacted legislation. You seen $4 million come from Lansing, $2 million from leak adjustments, and $2 million more.
Councilman, can I just jump in real quick?
Yeah, you can jump in, but I don't want you to think that we don't understand being fiscally responsible. When we talk about a part of 400 and some thousand, and then, Mr. President, when I was trying to get Ms. Henderson to understand, even with the 15,000 or 30,000, a smaller amount, you got volunteerism. You ain't got us just standing back howling about get it done, contract it out. There are some quicker ways where that's where I threw myself in the mix. Me and community leaders, we willing to knock some of this stuff out.
Councilman,
thank you.
I think what we've got is a difference of opinion, your guys' opinion, about what needs to be done with that money, and then maybe council's opinion on that. So what I would suggest to council is that somebody make that motion to set aside $200,000 for weed abatement. And then what we will do is take that difference of opinion to the RTAB, because she said that she doesn't support that move, which—
Mr. President.
Just let me finish, which is fine. And then we let the RTAB make that—
Well, Mr. President,
final determination.
I hear you and I will make a motion, but I wanted Ms. Henderson and Ms. Lundquist, I've seen them there talking. I'm not sure that they might not make a decision. So I want to really hear from them before I make any motion for any kind of amount.
I would only say that we're the ones who are supposed to make the decision tonight. They've given us their advice about what they think is the best course for the city. Now we need to take some action as to what we think is the best course.
That'll be fine, Mr. President. After I hear what Ms. Henderson has to say, and then I'll make that decision and maybe a motion. If you will, could we hear what she had to say? I've seen them there jotting and talking.
Oh, we were definitely taking these things into consideration. And then also, we are at the end of a fiscal year, so by the time that we get to the RTAB, this year will be over. So it wouldn't.
That's my point.
Dollars carry over from year to year.
They do, but you would still, in effect, need to be amending. What would need to be amended is the 016.
016.
So
but if you set it aside for a specific purpose, wouldn't that do the same thing?
No. What I'm saying is it.
So when I allocate something in the water fund, a project that doesn't get done in this current fiscal year, I got to go in and amend the budget for the next fiscal year.
But why would you intentionally allocate in one year something that you know you can't get done in that year?
Have you done that in this year's? Has that been done in this year's budget in the water and sewer fund for projects that aren't going to be done this fiscal year?
But why would you intentionally do
that? Why did you? I'm asking
it's
you.
It's not intentional. You can't know when projects are going to be finished.
The GAC, for example.
You don't know when projects will be finished.
The carbon filter. Did we allocate those dollars?
In July, however.
Which is the next fiscal year?
That money it's encumbered.
Okay. So I'm just asking to encumber these dollars.
I would like to say, since we're in this forum, it would be nice if we could, being that I hear a lot of, we'll go to the RTAB or just take it to the RTAB, it would be nice if the council could actually work together and work with administration to and listen to some of the things that we bring forward so that at some point the city can operate without an RTAB, but to always not ever be able to agree on anything.
Well, I wouldn't say that's true. The last RTAB meeting, I think there was one thing that we didn't agree on out of whatever the number of items that they had. So I don't believe that we disagree with the administration on everything that you bring forward, but I think there are some things that we have differences of opinion on.
Mr. President.
And they're the same things that got the city in this situation in the first place. So I just would like to say that. These are the same types of decisions that have not been made, and you have the opportunity to make your own decisions and to make the decisions so that you don't have an RTAB. But these are the types of decisions that have to be made. There are some hard decisions that have to be made. And these are some of those. Knowing that you have something that you have to do. The city will have to do a reappraisal of every lot, every piece of land, everything in the city. And you know that cost is coming forward. So those are things, those are the real decisions that have to be made. And I just wanted to make that statement because I'm here to work with you. I understand that we need lots to be cut. And that's why we're working with the DPW funding that we have to be able to do some things. And that's why we're going back with the CDBG funding to see what we can do as far as the neighborhood cleanup. But to say I'm just going to get out of receivership to start to transition out and I'm going to take $200,000 now, that does not show that the council is willing to move forward in trying to be able to function without the state. It just doesn't say that.
Mr. President, through you to Ms. Henderson. Ms. Henderson, if we are leaving this fiscal year and headed into the new one on July 1st, and if what I'm telling you has merit with the exchange hub, that's the old Salem housing, and remember I told you that they catching heck with the CDG block grant money because of the three bids and the specs. I wouldn't care if some of that funding went back because they haven't spent it. It could be reallocated. I don't know where it's at, but for what we're telling you as an urgent matter, I would try to move and make an amendment that a check be wrote tomorrow to that exchange hub. Because if we transfer them this type of money, they could go out and get the equipment. And I'm telling you, that's a clean, fast way to do it in this fiscal year. We could transfer money before July 1st and we would be somewhat on our way. Whether it was 15,000, 30,000, or 45, because for those two sets, the zero turn and the walking brush hog, each of those two cost 15,000. So two sets of them would be 30,000, three sets of them would be 45,000, and therefore you've got some action. And you got action for each ward, and you got some movement for a cheaper cost. So being fiscally responsible that way and understanding that we're serious about it, because when I say I'll put on my overalls and spend time under that umbrella policy, those are the type things that I think shows a working relationship in the interim. Would you be acceptable to those type of smaller expenditures versus the $200,000 in this fiscal year if we made the amendment? And Mr. President, if she can respond to that after that with what I hear, I'll be ready to make a motion one way or another. I'll try it, Mr. President. I would.
Let me just interrupt too, because I think a lot of the problem here is that there is a lack of flow of information from what you guys are doing and the problems that we talk about at council meetings. I think we've talked about block grant funding at previous council meetings, probably at least the last two P&D committee meetings, and ask for some information and ask to have that discussion. And for whatever reason, if it's on our side or if it's on your side, we never get around to actually having that discussion about what those priorities are or what is being done by the administration. So then when we get here and we're getting phone calls from residents who, like Councilman Nelson said, you can't get out a street because the grass is so tall. I mean, I had the same thing when I was on my way from work there on Davidson Road to here today, cutting across Iowa and Kersley Park. There's a disconnect between what you guys are doing to try to address some of the issues that we're raising, and when residents are calling us and asking us, well, what are you doing? And we don't know, because there's not that, at least for me anyways, I don't know if it's this, if it's true for everybody else, but we don't know what you're doing. And when we ask questions, well, we'll get back with you on that piece of information, and then, you know, a couple months later, then we maybe have an answer after the fact, or we don't, and we've moved on. So we've got to find a way to do a better job of making our committee meetings more productive, so that we're getting the information, the questions that we're asking. So I don't know how we do that, but we've got to find a way to do that. I've got Councilman
You want the motion?
Davis. If you want to make a motion.
I'll make the motion, and then it'll send a message. If I try to give them a way out and they don't pay attention for the purposes of discussion, I'll move that we make the amendment of $200,000 from the $400-some-odd, and I so move.
Support.
And we making that amendment for the purposes of cutting this high grass and weeds.
Councilman Davis, and I have Councilwoman Poplar.
Ms. Henderson, I just think that maybe at some point in time that you should maybe just go out and drive around and look and see the urgency of the grass needing to be cut, because the grass is tall, and you have a lot of elderly people that are a little apprehensive about going to their cars and getting out at night because they don't know who may be hiding in that grass. And we know that Flint has a high crime rate. And we also know that people are living in desperate times. And most of the time, they're trying to seek out and prey on elderly people. And it just brings forth some form of a fear in them when they got grass so tall next to their house. I get a lot of complaints about it in my ward. I do go on my drive line more, and I do cut a lot of lots in my community. I do, but I can't cut them all. But I just think maybe if you just took a little drive through, which I believe that you will eventually, just drive through the community over by your area and going north and a little east, just to get a little understanding of what's the urgency of this and why do we make such of a make such of an issue out of it, because it is a big issue. I think last year we had the same problem, and I brought something to the table asking, could we be proactive in preventing this from happening this year? It was way it preceded you coming here. But I think if you just take that opportunity and just drive through just to see how really bad it is, and then maybe you can get better a better understanding of why why we are so avid on trying to really get this issue resolved. I really do think if you've done this, you can see the urgency because it really needs to be cut. It really does. And I think at some point in time, we have to be sacrificial in our approach in trying to resolve a lot of the issues that the people are suffering from. I know $200,000 sounds like a lot of money, but I think that the necessity of us getting this issue resolved, it will bring back some form of a relief to the residents and also to a relief to local officials, because it's a small issue, but it's an issue that compounds on top of people having a lack of trust in us. And because that's what we're lacking as well. We don't have no trust in local government. And I think if we can address these needs, it can actually bring us closer than where we are today in building the trust back with the residents and the community. I mean, because when you look in this city council meeting today and we see I can't count 15 to 20 people in here, this shows a sign to me that local government has actually lost all of trust. And I think it comes a point in time that we just have to be sacrificial. I know the numbers and I know that the money seems real detrimental, and we try our hardest not to go back to where we once was at. But in the long haul, we will see a better day as opposed to having money for a rainy day. But I think that we should take some of this money out and be able to address some of the dire needs that people are suffering from, and particularly the elderly people, because they are the ones who's really a little apprehensive about just doing anything. They don't even want to come sit on their porch because they don't know what's sitting next door to them. And I've saw it, even in Smith Village. I mean, the grass is as tall as me. And I know I'm not that tall, but it's real tall. It's taller than me. And I think that is something that we need to address. And I think we should do that. And I think we should be sacrificial. Let's think about that. And also think about taking in your car and just drive around and just see how bad it is, because it's bad. It really is. That's all I have to say. And I hope that we can get this issue addressed so that we can bring peace back into the elderly community and make sure that they live in a safe and decent environment where that we see that their tax dollars is being afforded to them in the manner that it should be afforded. Thank you.
Councilwoman Popper. Okay. Is there any further discussion? Can we have roll call, please?
Mr. President, I was asking the city attorney about budgets and could she spend money, could Ms. Henderson choose if she choose to do something with that money. Through you, Mr. President, to the city attorney, can you let him chime in, because I want to make sure I understand that she has that ability.
Well, there's two things that I think you're talking about. One is the purchasing ordinance that affords the city administrator discretion on expenditures under $75,000, and clearly she has that power. However, she doesn't have the power to unilaterally amend the budget. So expenditures would have to be within the budgeted dollars.
Mr. President, through you to the city attorney, if we do a budget amendment today, based on what I heard, it won't take effect until the RTAB approves it. Is that right or wrong?
That's right. I mean, any resolution you pass today would require RTAB approval.
Right. So if we amend the budget now and the fiscal year start 2016, really what we did don't give us an ending year balance in the black, because nothing will happen until the RTAP meet. So this budget amendment should have been done technically at the last RTAP meeting, or they should have a special meeting tomorrow. So that means the city of Flint is going to end up in the red.
Well, I think the another way of saying is that if council wanted to reallocate dollars for weed cutting, the conversation should have occurred earlier, not on June 29th.
Yeah, that's what I'm getting at. I see you, Ms. Lutquist. Ms. Lutquist, you and the city administrator seem to think that I'm wrong. But let me ask you this question. If the budget is not officially amended until the RTAB approves what we do, or until the RTAB amended, and the RTAB ain't scheduled to meet until maybe July the 15th, my question to you is, I understand the counting purposes, but in reality, when July 1st hit, without this amendment, we gonna end up with deficits in certain funds?
Ms. Lundquist?
Mr. President, the city will end exactly how it will end with actual activity, whether or not the council takes any action tonight. So we will end with fund balances across the board, but in order to be compliant with the Uniform Budget and Accounting Act, we are requesting that the council review the budget and what has been proposed with activity year to date and what we anticipate ending tomorrow at, and to amend then our fiscal year ending June 30, 2015 budget to be reflective of those projections.
So, Mr. President, I hear what she said, but Ms. Lundquist, you are our new financial director, correct?
Correct.
And Ms. Lundquist, this is what I understand. I understand that you don't have the power to amend the budget. The council does. I understand in certain cases, the city administrator can act as the council and the mayor. I remember reading something like that. And then I also understand whatever we or she do is finally approved by the RTAB. Now, I know you coming from Benton Harbor, but my question and my understanding is this. If the RTAB has to approve this budget amendment, and if Wednesday is July the 1st, it is what it is. It's no technical way without an emergency meeting of the RTAB, in Councilman May's mind, that we gonna end the year with an ending fund balance. If without these amendments, if any fund has a deficit, there's no way to technically correct it without action of the RTAB. And if you think that I'm wrong, then I want you to give me a written opinion of how in the next 7 days. Because whatever happens this fiscal year, I don't want it to happen the end of the next fiscal year. Because right now I believe, and Ms. Henderson, if you see different, you can tell me. But I know I used to get all A's and one B. And I just don't understand technically how our action that have to be approved by the RTAB and what I read in the newspaper, like we was gonna come here, vote on something, and by the time we get to July 1st, we was gonna have a budget that ended with all everything fixed because of an amendment. And now that I think about it, I'm like, no, it won't be fixed until, even if we voted to approve it, it wouldn't become official until the RTAP met. Now, Mr. Freeman, am I missing something?
I think you are. I think that, you know, our final numbers are reflected in an audit that's probably not done till August, September, October, November sometime. I think that there are adjustments made even while they're conducting the audit where they see mistakes. So The audit reflects what our final numbers are, not a fourth quarter budget amendment.
So did he explain that correctly?
After the close of the fiscal year, there are journal entries and activity that is posted to June 30, so we won't know what the numbers are until those closing procedures are done, and they will be affirmed by the annual audit in the fall of this year. But may also respond, I need to point out that I will not put anything in writing. I am not an attorney. I will leave that to counsel. But my opinion, both from experience and as the finance director, is that the city council has been asked to approve the budget amendment for the fourth quarter to be compliant with the Uniform Budget and Accounting Act. You could choose not to do that. However, it's not going to change actual activity. It will just ultimately result in an audit finding. If you'd like to have that conversation with the state, by all means, that is up to you. But you are ultimately the highest elected governing authority in the city of Flint, and the RTAB's decision to either affirm or deny the action that you take tonight doesn't have bearing upon the action of the council.
So you're saying, regardless of what action we take, you gonna transfer the monies and do
absolutely
whatever
not,
you
sir.
Beg your pardon?
Absolutely not.
So you saying if we don't amend it, you're not gonna transfer the money and make all of the accounts balance. But if we do amend it, then you'll make the transfers as reflected in the amendments.
Correct.
So that means even though the RTAB might affirm or concur or whatever, what we do tonight is going to reflect what you do in the interim. If we don't make these amendments, you're not going to make the appropriate transfers.
I do not have the authority.
And so that's why what we do tonight is relevant. But you might not have no authority, but if we didn't approve the amendments, then Ms. Henderson might order you to do those transfers.
No.
No?
No, if you read the ordinance, we have 45 days, I believe, from the time a budget amendment is presented. The order says if we don't act in a timely fashion, so if we didn't act within those 45 days, she could act in our place, but we have 45 days to make that amendment, according to the ordinance.
Okay, finally, because I know you're ready to call for the vote on the amendment. Ms. Henderson, we gets no cooperation from you. You know, it kind of trips me out to have to make a $200,000 amendment when we sit here and I tried to make it clear, show us something. You know, and we had from 15 to 30 to 45,000. I mean, it's a give and take. We hear what you're saying, but by repeating the same thing over and over again, you know, why should we have to fight in a public arena? Why we can't have some type of give and take? Because believe me, politically, you know, it's certain people who, if you push them, they ain't gonna like it. And you might think that it's really not correct, but keep this in mind, Ms. Henderson. Some of us still believe, just like y'all went to the Supreme Court on the water issue, and we know that's a serious issue, some of us still believe in Judge Stee. And Judge Stee is a federal court judge who done found a prima facie finding for 52% of the black population who had emergency managers and things done, while the other folks of other persuasions didn't get emergency manager. And keep in mind what your contract says. We can make complaints under your contract about you, and then we can start fighting with you. And you know, you've been from Muskegon Heights to Flint to wherever you go. And I'm saying, why start fights politically with folks when sometime all it takes is a little give and take at the right time? Is there anything you want to say before we vote on this $200,000 amendment? Are you willing to change your thought? Thank you, Mr. Point. I'm political, and I am here to be political.
Hang on a minute. We're not even here talking about contract right now, so let's
You done made your point, so that means I'm ready to vote, Mr. President, but I want to make it clear to Ms. Henderson, I am political.
Okay.
And I am here to be political.
Councilman, we're going to move on to the vote now. Can we get a roll call on the amendment?
The $200,000 amendment?
Right.
Okay, Mr. Mays?
Yes.
Ms. Popola?
Yes.
Mr. Nelson?
Yes.
Mr. Freeman?
Yes.
Mr. Davis?
Yes.
Mr. Winfrey?
Yes.
Ms. Galloway?
Yes.
The vote is 7 yes, 0 no.
So that would make a 150488.1. And do we have a motion to adopt that?
Yeah, Mr. President.
Is this a motion?
No, the motion already been made. We was in discussion the whole time.
We amended it?
We amended it. Now we're getting ready to, I guess, vote on the motion that's been made. But I was wondering what my colleagues, Ms. Poplar and Mr. Nelson, with that $200,000 amendment, I'm curious to see where do they stand. Do they believe that was the grass issue, or they still said without the grass issue they wasn't supporting this? I'm just curious.
Why don't we go ahead and take roll call on that?
No, I don't want to wait the roll call. I'm curious to see where they stand.
Can we have roll
through
on
you,
the,
Mr. President.
On the resolution.
Through you, Mr. President, to Ms. Poplar. Ms. Poplar, can you tell me if that addressed your issue?
Can we
have
roll
call? She pleaded the Fifth Amendment.
Roll call.
Ain't that crazy?
Ms. Poplar?
Yes.
Mr. Nelson?
Yes.
Mr. Freeman?
Yes.
Mr. Davis?
Yes.
Mr. Winfrey?
Yes.
Ms. Galloway?
Yes.
Mr. Mays?
Yes.
The vote is 7 yes, 0 no.
Motion passes. Next item on our agenda is public speaking. Public speakers?
Okay.
We have a couple.
Sure. The first public speaker is Mr. R.L. Mitchell. Mr. Mitchell?
I'm Mr. R.L. Mitchell, President. I want to talk on this political situation. Ms. Henderson says she's not here for a political situation, but Mays is. I just, for instance, like the prayer we're supposed to pray before we start this, we never did use this time. And I read the paper and I saw the remarks with the lady that said the prayer. And Ms. Henderson talking about taxing everybody on the thing and her sidekick, Armor Ballard, making more money than anybody on that proactive situation. But she's in the prayer, I know she had to get permission from Scott Kincaid, but Scott said, long as she don't pray, but by doing that wasn't a prayer. Now you see what happened within one day of that prayer, Supreme Court then throwed a monkey wrench in there and messed up the whole system, and nobody around here saying nothing. Just like Ms. Henderson, we in the red, but by tomorrow, we in the black, but by tomorrow we're gonna be in the red. And you sitting up there like it ain't, and the only person who's gonna straighten this out is the mayor, Mays. He talking in the right position of the mayor. And Ms. Henderson in there with the mayor downstairs behind closed doors. And who knows what the no's do behind closed doors? And you see what happened over there with that marriage stuff, and nobody said nothing about it in the Supreme Court, and nobody ain't trying to take this young lady money because this is her sidekick. She should have all that money. Keep coming back, lady. And Miss Henderson, you know we put.
We got her in the kitchen.
I love you too. Oh, my goodness, Josh, I can't hardly. When you're in love with a beautiful woman, it's hard, but with an administrator, but as a man got to know his role in the House, in the Supreme Court, done messed up and can't clean up. That's all I'm gonna say. But May's gonna clean up.
Thank you.
This day.
Thank you, Mr. Mitchell.
Our next speaker is Mr. A.C. Dumas. Mr. Dumas.
Good evening.
Good evening. A.C. Dumas, 533 East Rankin Street. And of course, I have a lot to say, but a little short time said, so I'm going to say it very quick. Councilman Kincaid said that the people, the public, are not as smart as you all, and did no one up there that was here disagree with him. So certainly I take offense to it. I want to say that, you know, I've heard the budgets and certain issues. I saw the budget. When we talk about the assets are being part to make a part of the budget funding, we have to ask ourselves the question, as it relates to buildings and so lands and so on and so forth, who are appraising the buildings and the different assets that owned by the city that goes in to make up that budget? And I understand assets and liabilities. And so if you're going to tell me that the city assessor does that, whoever he or it, that company may be, that's like having the dog guarding a chicken coop. And always remember that math is an exact science. You can make math, you can make numbers any way you want, as long as they balance. And state law does require that you all have, every city has a balanced budget. Also, we're talking about $7 million that was borrowed from the state. Well, when you say borrowed, that implies that it has to be paid back. And my mama told me years ago that you can't borrow your way out of debt. And I know that's to be true. You cannot borrow your way out of debt. Also, as I have several points, but this point was very important for me, to reappraise property, the reappraisal of properties. Now, my little house over there on Rankin Street ain't worth that much, no way. I don't care how much I put it up, I mean, make improvements or whatever. And so what they're suggesting is that these little shacks that most of us live in, even if you live in a good area, they're going to raise our property. They're going to reappraise. You don't reappraise unless you want to raise. You're certainly not going to reappraise President Freeman to make it go down. So maybe we didn't get a clear understanding because we're as not as smart as you all up there. Thank you. Bye now.
I'll just respond real briefly. The reason that the state has ordered a reappraisal, ordered a reappraisal is because the number of cases that are coming to the Michigan Tax Tribunal and that the city is losing is an indication that our appraisals are off. And if you look at what Detroit has done with their reappraisals, the majority of those properties have come down, which my guess is we're going to be the same thing in the city of Flint.
The next speaker is Mrs. Carolyn Shannon.
Good evening.
Good evening to the Honorable Council, Mr. President Josh Freeman, and the lovely City Clerk Inez Brown. I am appalled at these two women making over $200,000 together, and they can't count very well. No one should get $95,000 if they can't count. It's very elementary. If you don't have it, you don't spend it. And Mr. Dumas was right, you can't borrow your way out of debt. I haven't been able to do that. But as long as I live, as long as I breathe, I will be fighting for the city of Flint. And I may suggest that the next leaders of this city hall be for the citizens of Flint. If you love Flint, you will fight for the citizens. I can't pay for Mayor Dane Walling's future through the water pipeline, but I have already paid with working in this community for so many years for my presence. I've paid for my presence. And when they do the budget again, I want them not only to give me all of my money back, I do believe in paying my fair share, but they have overcharged us, and I want a check, not for myself, because I am not greedy. I am not selfish. I want to see the city thrive. But with under this administration, it has gone downhill. If we're paying these people, carpetbaggers, a lot of money, look like they would work on our behalf. That means all of the citizens of Flint should get a check. And I'm asking for a check. I have paid close to $5,000 in the last 2 years. And I want my money back. And not only for me, I want the money back for the citizens of Flint. And we need to get rid of people that cannot count. And do not underestimate Mr. Mays. And do not underestimate God. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Our next speaker?
Our next speaker is Mr. Quincy Murphy. Mr. Murphy?
Good evening. I want to thank you guys for that vote for the $200,000. Hopefully that can help out in the community. But I'm here tonight to just invite you guys out. We've been doing things in Dewey Park. We got a meet up and group, eat up with the kids. We feed the kids in the neighborhood Monday through Friday from 1 to 2 and from 3 to 4 they eat snack. We brought bounce houses for them. They play in the park. So hopefully you guys will come out and it inspires your neighborhood groups to do some things in the park. So if y'all want to come out and look at what we're doing every day from Monday through Friday, today we had like 35 kids in the park, and their parents come with them sometime, and they've been bringing other people in the park. So it's been a great experience for me. This is my first year doing it. We partner with G-Car, and they come and do 3 hot meals a week and 2 cold meals. And the kids really enjoy it. They look forward to playing in the park. So if you guys aren't doing anything, just come to Dewey Park. It's right behind Sylvester Broom Center. Thank you.
Great time.
Every day from 1 to 4.
Thank you.
Our next speaker is Mr. Chris Del Moroni.
Thank you. My name is Chris Del Moroni. I live in Flint, Michigan. And there's a lot to go through, and so you know, if you want to take some notes or whatever, but I couldn't believe what I was hearing here. CBDG funding. They're talking about that to cut money for grass. Well, remember, this is a different budget year, but we took about over $800,000 to do from the CBDG. We used that money to tear down the towers. That could have, I've been saying this since then, you could have spent that money in the neighborhoods. What I'm also hearing is $900,000. I've talked years and years about this, that Consumers Energy had a rebate to the city, to the residents of Flint. And if that is true, what I say to council is you need to adopt the resolution that $900,000 goes back to the community, back to the residents, because that's where it came from. And you heard probably hundreds of residents over the years say, hey, that light assessment's wrong. And I've been telling you for years, it is wrong. Because we're paying for lights that, when they're not working, we pay for them. They're not individually metered, and you need to be looking at that. And Consumers Energy should be responsible. We just can't keep paying them money, tell the residents, pay more money, and then Consumers does their own audit, And they say, oh, you know, we've been charging you $900,000 too much. And then they give you $900,000, and none of it comes back to the residents who paid for it. Makes no sense. On your budget, Mr. Councilman Mays, you're going in the right direction. You need a couple more questions. You need to ask for an income statement of what's going into each fund, water and sewer, and how much is coming out, because they're mixing things on you, whether it's legal that they do that or not, but you just can't figure out the apples and the oranges, because it's just one number. You need to find out how much are the residents paying every month, because I FOIA'd it. You know what they told me? Cost you $4,000, it's 8,000 pages long. Well, I ain't gonna do that. Okay, you need to find out how much money is going in, how much is coming out, on a monthly basis into the four accounts, water, sewer, service, and service, okay, for each of them. And that's where you gotta go. When they tell you that this is the amount in there, and they say, well, some of it's cash and some of it's assets, well, how much is cash then? I mean, you know, work with them. I'm also hearing that what is being taped here for, it's not even put on Comcast anymore, and it's being audited. I mean, Flint, Michigan may have its own little Watergate going right now, okay? So I think council needs to make a referral or something to the city attorney's office and find out what is it being audited and why and what's being taken out or added. I don't, hopefully they're not adding anything, but it's just that right. Well,
Thank you. Just one last thing.
You know, they also said they don't have the money for the neighborhoods. Find out where they got the money to do the new employee parking lot, the pavement, the lights, and to trim all the trees around City Hall. I mean, that money had to come from somewhere. And I think it's just fair to the residents when you say, we can't take care of the grass in your neighborhood because the administration won't give us the money. Then the next sentence is, they spent the money for the parking lot and back. Because actually, you know, new lights out there, that's very limited usage. Early in the morning, certain times of the year, late at night, certain times of the year. Otherwise, you don't really even need lights in the employee parking lot. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Gentleman.
Our next speaker is Mr. Arthur Woodson. Mr. Woodson.
Good evening.
Good evening. I didn't really have too much to say because Mr. Kincaid isn't here today, and I really wanted to make a point to him that he's not smarter than all of us. You know, I was really offended from that. And me, myself, I can interpret it any way I want to, because the way that he said it, he made it sound like he had Confederate drawers on. You know, I really was offended behind that. But after that council meeting, I went home and I researched abatement. Every abatement that GM gave out, it was a give and take. They retained the employees in Wayne, Michigan, Detroit, Michigan, and Delta Township. Just June the 2nd, they did an abatement with a small small part factory where they added 43 more employees at a 50% abatement. Each one of them had added employees and they were able to retain the employees that was there. We got an abatement and all we gave them was 50%, but we didn't get any new employees. I spoke to EPA today too regarding TTHM. They said that they had a guy here working by the name of Michael Wright under the technical advisory. I never heard of him. I never saw him before. They told me today that they sent out an email 2 days ago to MDEQ and to Michael Wright, and they wanted to add two more people to Flint to work on their water source, and MDEQ and Flint will not get back in touch with them. So you all need to get in touch with this Michael Wright, because if the MDEQ doesn't accept these two, and they say they're for lead, research development in EPA, If MDEQ does not get in touch with them, Flint's supposed to ask for them, but I doubt if that even happened. So on this end, you need to find out who is Michael Wright. He's on the technical group, water advisory group or something, they said, and get with him and find out if you can accept or if you want that person to come in and help. They specialize in the lead that's in the water, and they said they was the highest in EPA, US EPA. So, you know, that's something that y'all need to look into. Thank you.
Thank you. You guys sing for us tonight?
Our last speaker is Mrs. Gertrude Marshall. Mrs. Marshall.
Good evening.
Good evening. I just want to say thank you guys for implementing prayer into the city council. Hopefully it helps. I'm sure it will. And I also just want to say what I was hearing, how they don't want to spend the $200,000 on cleaning up the city, on cutting down the grass. I'm not understanding that. You guys just fixed the building in the basement for the Department of Public Works, and you spent $40,000 to fix that section up, to move them from one office to another. And that's just for an office, and you mean to tell me there's a problem with cutting grass and doing what needs to be done for the city? I'm not understanding that. But I'm sure you guys will fix that. I know y'all will take care of that. Thank you.
Thank you.
That's
it. Is that it? Yeah. Okay, a couple things. I think Ms. Shannon and Mr. Dumas both brought up about not borrowing our way out of debt, and that's true. We still owe that debt, that deficit. Basically, all we've done is refinance that deficit. So that instead of spending $1.8 million a year, we're going to spend about $500,000 a year over a longer period of time. So we still have that debt. We're just able to manage it a little bit better. Mr. Del Moroni, you asked about City Hall improvements. Every resident in the city of Flint, property owner in the city of Flint, pays a public improvement tax that can only be used for building improvements. And that's where you see those dollars being spent. It's not general fund money. It's not money that could be used to go out and mow lawns. It's not money that could be used to hire police officers. It's a very charter-specific use, and that's what it's being used for. And that would be the same thing, Ms. Marshall, that office change down there that came out of public improvement money, which is specifically for those purposes and can't be used for anything else.
And Mr. President, it should be used to fix that roof at the mini station over there on Bishop and Martin Luther King and that air conditioning unit. So send that down as a referral from this meeting, because we've been hollering about the mini station roof and air conditioning unit with that same type of money.
Public improvement. You're right. Okay. Council discussion. Let's try to limit our comments to 5 minutes, and we'll start with Councilman Mays.
55 minutes.
Maybe next meeting.
I would first say, Mr. Dumas and Mr. Woodson, Mr. Kincaid, don't speak for me. I heard from y'all, if it's true or not, that he said after I left and went to make copies during the last council meeting, he alluded to the fact that we as council members are smarter than people in the public. I don't know if he said it or not, but if he did say it, he don't speak for me. It's people in the community just as smart or smarter than Councilman Mays. Now, keep in mind, when people say stuff, you gotta consider the source, and everybody don't speak for me. Even Mr. Freeman is the president, and according to the charter, he's the spokesperson for the council, whoever the president is. But he don't always agree and speak for me. So just for the record, I don't know what's being said or what was said, but I don't really think nobody should say that we smarter than people in the public. Also, I would like to say this. Mr. Freeman, we did, in my opinion, need to make a point as it relates to that grass cutting. 200,000 might have been a little much, I don't know. But I want to make a referral that we get a detailed analysis of what we spend with the land bank annually for cutting and how much they spend when they cut, you know, throughout the year. Because when they cut, I don't know if they separate their land bank property and the city of Flint's land bank property, but I want a detailed breakdown, so we'll
put that on the next planning and development.
That'll be fine. So I want to make that referral. And then also, you know, particularly as we move forward in the month of July, I'm going to ask that I want to send a referral for the mayor to attend these council meetings. Because I know if I'm the mayor, I'm going to be in council meetings with my staff each and every time. But because of politics and because of what's going on and my first duty as a council person, and my first duty as a mayor is to take care of the city of Flint and the residents thereof, I'm going to make a referral and ask that the mayor and the city administrator attend both committee and or council meetings for this month of July. And so I want to send that down as a referral. I would say to the citizens of Flint and to the council, you know, these meetings used to be not only just on YouTube, but on Channel 17. And I've heard Paul talk about the contract coming up with Comcast. I want us to stay on top of that Comcast contract negotiation. And I also want to send a referral down to the administration that I want these back on Channel 17. And so whatever it takes, I want these meetings back on Channel 17 because people who can't attend watches them. And then finally, I would like to, I've been enjoying this year and 6 months on the city council, and I've been enjoying my interaction with the people out in the community. And I'm enjoying some of the feedback I'm getting. I'm very disappointed in the city administration and or the city attorney's office as it relates to this second trial that's set for April the 11th in Judge Perry's court. We will get ready to go into a trial again. Remember, some of my colleagues, and I can name them, Kincaid, Nolan, the mayor, then City Administrator Donnie Early, they wanted me to resign before I had been to trial the first time, and I told them, be careful because you were wrong. Now I'm here to tell you, we're down to a traffic ticket per se, and it's the first traffic ticket in 40 years, you know, if it's found guilty, but never in the history of the city of Flint have a regular citizen, let alone a council person, been on tether for close to a year now. And do you know, as I get ready to wind down, Mr. President, and to my colleagues, do you know that if I violate or had violated a tether, you're guilty of a 5 to 10 year felony? Now, how outrageous is that? You facing a misdemeanor traffic ticket the whole time. You don't lose your council seat for a misdemeanor traffic ticket. Normally the fine is $500 fine and a driver's responsibility fee. Right now with Judge Farrah overturning Judge Perry, I'm innocent of anything and an already paid all kind of fees. Been on tether for close to a year, facing a 5 to 10 year felony, and the city administrator and or the city attorney still wants to come at me, in my opinion, penalty been served. So I just wanted to say that in closing. Politics is a son of a gun, but the people of the city ain't stupid. And Councilman Mays, never have been stupid a day in my life. I pray that we cut all the nonsense out and that we get ready to continue to move this city forward.
Thank you,
Mr. Councilman. President, thank me after I say this. My cell number is 922-4860. That's primarily for First Ward residents. 922-4860, because everybody in the First Ward who calls me know when they call me as a council person, I do a three-way call. I've done them with the chief of police who's sitting there, and I applaud him for putting undercover out there and doing some things. I call and do a three-way with street maintenance as it relates to potholes, trees getting cut, so forth and so on. So, Mr. President, in keeping with what I'm supposed to do, I even appreciate that letter that was sent to you politically, and we took care of that. 922-4860.
Thank you.
That's
Councilman.
How the First Ward and anybody else get in touch with Councilman Mays. Councilman, thank you.
Councilman Nelson. Councilman Davis.
I just wanted to say to AC and Mr. Woodson that I echo that as well, that nobody speaks for me. I don't think that I'm smarter than anyone in each ward. I don't share that belief, and if you were offended, I apologize. What any of my elected officials may have said to offend you, I apologize for that myself, because I think that you are afforded an apology for saying that. I also want to state that, Mr. Dumas, you are absolutely correct that we cannot continue to borrow our way out of a deficit. But I always tell the people over and over, even when I'm out campaigning, that the only way Flint is going to strive or thrive in the manner that we desire is that we have to have an economic and development plan. We have to get people off the street and get people to working. When you're lacking income and property taxes, you use other departments to pay for those bills. And I believe that those departments, and one particular department that is being used, is the water and sewer fund. You can't continue to do that, because the way that they reimburse themselves is they raise your water rates up. But I honestly believe that in order for us to become somewhere in the green where we desire to be, or take a step in the green, is that we have to get people off the street. We got too many people in this city that are living below poverty, and we got too many people with felonies on their record and cannot get a job. That's not safe, that's not good for public safety, and that's not good for our economy. So I think that in order for this city to really proclaim themselves to be out of a deficit and be moving to put money away for a rainy day, that we have to generate good income and property taxes. And the only way we can do that is that we have to bring some jobs here that would not discriminate nor not be biased towards people who desire to work. Because if that doesn't happen, it's nowhere we're going to ever move. And even if we have a balanced budget and we can proclaim ourselves to be clear from any deficit, we also have liabilities that we can also be in a deficit. So having a balanced budget don't always mean that you're safe. It just means that we're not placed in a bad position, that we're spending more money than what we're receiving in. It seemed like it's just being redundant saying it all the time, and I hope that it never lies on deaf ears, but the only way that we're going to move forward is that we have to get people off the street and get people into the workforce. The 70s and the 80s, we didn't go through this, because I am a 70s baby. Everybody was basically considered middle-class people because they was working. The auto industry is no longer in existence. It's no longer vibrant as it once was. But there are other avenues and other ways that we can establish some form of work where that we can be better today than we was yesterday. And that's the only way that we're going to able become vibrant, is that we have to stop saying it and start figuring out how we're going to get people off the street and get people to work. We have a safer community. We have better income and property taxes coming in. And people living expenses would not be as high as it is now. And it would minimize the frustration and the distress and the anger that is so vibrant and resonates through our community that sometimes, if not all the time, most people are acting irrational because they've lost hope, they're deprived, and they just cannot see how their life going to move from one point to the next point. So I believe in my heart that Flint will be a better place to live when we establish a strong economic and development plan. And we got to quit saying it, and we got to quit always thinking that downtown is going to be the center of this. It has to transpire way much farther than downtown. It has to head to the north, the south, the east, and the west side. Because we've experienced, and I know the chief is in here right now, the last number I had was 26 murders, and we've just been 8 days in the summer. It may be probably at 30 now. It's going to be a horrible day when we get to the end of the summer. There's a lot of frustration. There's a lot of people deprived. Economically, the city is not able to address a lot of our bills that we have to pay in dealing with the services. And most importantly, you got people that can't even pay a $25 metro telephone bill. We have to address this issue somewhere. I wish that I had a magic wand when I was able to do that. But unfortunately, all of Flint's economic and development funds has been invested into uptown development and chambers of commerce. I've never seen them put a job on the east and north side. It's always downtown. And the people who really needs the jobs that is creating all this havoc in our community is going to continue to be neglected and ignored. I hope someday that we really get our minds shifted in that direction and quit coming here singing lullaby songs and just saying what we need to do. And I can't wait until we become really solution driven and make all of our solutions a reality. At least get on a course where we can make it seem as if there is some hope in this community, because right now we have become bankrupt when it comes to hope, when it comes to morals and values. And most of the people walking the streets right now has just lost the value of human life. Every day you turn on the news, it just aches in my heart that you see so many people dying every day. Every day. That's what we expect to see when we turn on the news. Somebody getting shot, somebody getting ran over, somebody robbing a convenience store, somebody doing this, somebody doing that. We've become morally bankrupt in this city. And there's no money here to really put people in the workforce, but we have to travel outside of this state and let people know, come in, bring your jobs, bring manufacturing jobs, where that we can get people on the assembly line and get the producing. Production is what we need. And until we do this, I tell you, there's no way we're going to get any way of resolving any of our problems until we get people off the street and get people to start having a good livelihood. Because right now, people are living in desperate times. And I talk to them every day, and they just lost hope. And I'm telling you, until we do this, it's just, I feel sometimes it's like Noah. And I said it last time, and I'm going to get off. It's like Noah. When Noah was telling the people that the flood was going to come, they laughed and they giggled and they joked and they did everything else to make him look like he was an idiot, he was a fool. But when the flood came, they got the knocking at the door and nobody let them in. This is what's going to happen in Flint. People is going to come knocking at our door and it's going to be a horrible knock. And a lot of times they're not even going to ring the doorbell. They're going to come through the window and we're going to be saying to ourselves one day, how did we let it get this way? It's just going to be cowboys and Indians. It's going to be a sad day. We got to get people off the street. We got to generate hope and values and morals back into the hearts and the minds of the people that's been feeling neglected. I'm through.
Thank you, Councilman. Councilman Winfrey.
Just briefly, Mr. President, to my colleagues and to all that are present, I look for the day when the administration and the council can work together to create and realize efficiencies for the taxpayers. That's what they deserve. That's what they're due. And I think this us against them syndrome has been created by the Public Act 436. And as we right this ship, and I think that we will, but as we right this ship, one of the things that I would really like for us to look more closely to, because we, every time I hear people talk, well, not every time, but much of the time when I hear people talk, they're talking about economic development. And I look at the contracts, I look at the millions of dollars that we handle, and I look at the contracts that we issue out to perhaps companies that don't invest back into this city or don't even reside in this city. And I'm not saying that every contract that we give out, there's somebody in the city that can do that work. I know better. But I think that we should monitor a little closer or a bit closer the contracts that we give out that could be spent right here. And I'm looking forward to that, and I'm going to make inquiries because I really want to know the amount of contract, the dollar amount of the contracts that we give out and how much of those dollars can stay right here with folks who can provide those services, who live in the city, who invest in the city, and we get a better return on our tax dollars. Thank you, Mr. And also to Mr. Dumas and certainly to Mr. Woodson, I echo the sentiments of my colleague, Mr. Mays. Mr. Kincaid, I respect Mr. Kincaid, but he doesn't speak for me. If you didn't hear me say that, don't charge anything to me, because if I hear you say something that I don't like, I'm coming to you. I'm not going to charge anybody else. So I echo his sentiments. I don't consider myself any, so I don't go around trying to measure who I'm smarter than. All I try to do is do my job.
Thank you, Councilman, Councilwoman.
Thank you, Council President. I was a little disappointed that Ms. Henderson didn't stay around to the end of the meeting. I too share the same sentiments as Councilman Winfrey in this hit us against them. And I'm concerned about that form of government. I think that the direction to go to the city manager form of government, if this is a picture of it, it's disappointing to me. And I've shared this with Natasha, Ms. Henderson. I don't think that there's an open-mindedness, and I share with her that there are times where our views are different, and I understand that you're not political, but you still, regardless of whether you're appointed or elected, should have the concern of your community at hand. And it can be the concern of the businesses. We don't just want businesses to come in. We need to still ensure that the residents remain, that they stay, that whenever we can, that even if it's not 200,000, if it's 75,000 to help move in that direction, I think it's a different thing. But I wonder if the administrative order that gives Natasha the power that she has doesn't make her, I don't know if she respects us, and I'm sorry that she feels that way. I would hope that my colleagues, like myself, would do what they can to educate themselves to the best of their ability to vote in a way that they feel comfortable with their one vote out of nine. And I just didn't hear that. I was disappointed by even hear us out as we hear you out. If you don't agree, don't make it seem like we're incapable. And that's kind of what I heard. And again, I don't want to just harp on that, but and I don't know if the news is true or the readings of the journal is true, stating that even when we voted on the tax abatement, that it had already been done. That's what if I'm not mistaken, either in the journal or on the news, it said that that Natasha Henderson had already approved the abatement. That's what it said in print. And so I don't know if that's true or not. But just the fact that that's leaked out there is an alarming thing, because it just continues to create a distrust. And so I don't want that type. I don't want Miss Jody Lindquist to have that kind of, you know, aura when you come into an arena like this. And I don't want always our decisions, you know, well, the RTAB. I would hope that they would, and I appreciate you, Mr. President, when you said there was only one thing on there that we disagreed with, and I don't think that our track record has been set that way. And so I just wanted to get that on the record, because as an administration, you have to be willing to work with us too. And when you don't get the calls from the people or accept the calls, or I know the city administrator is supposed to be out in the community more. That's supposed to be a major part of that position. Speaking with the residents, informing the residents why we're doing what we're doing and how much we're doing. And so until that happens, I don't think she'll have the same sentiments. Not that any of us are emotional, but it makes a difference when you're getting those phone calls from elderly residents saying, I got rodents, I got this. I got someone that called me the other day and said, hey, this house had been boarded up, and now people are trying to take the eaves trough off, and I tried to make noise, but I'm 90 years old, you know? And so let's just work together.
All right, we'll be fine. We'll get through it, and you know what? We're gonna disagree on a couple of things, and you disagree, and then you move on. You don't dwell on it, so. You know, we disagreed on this issue. The RTAB is going to make a decision that they're going to make, and we'll move on to the next issue. So we need a motion to adjourn.
Mr. President.
We've got a
motion
on the floor.
Adjourn.
Is there support?
Quickly.
It's been moved and supported. Can we have a roll call?
I know
roll
how
call.
To stop this.
Yes.
Okay. Watch what I'm going to do. It ain't going to pass.
Yes.
Mr. Winfrey?
Yes.
Ms. Galloway?
Yes.
Mr. Mays?
No.
Motion
fails. Motion fails.